Welcome to the subcommittee of the Health and Human Services Committee. I'd like to ask Senator Setzler to open us in prayer.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, the giver of all good things, we just praise you and thank you for all that you're doing in our lives. We pray, Lord, that we would be mindful of the least of these, Lord, that you've called us to serve and be mindful of. Pray that we would humble ourselves before you. Pray that you give us the wisdom that only you can give. Bless these proceedings today, that we would ask hard questions, that we would understand truth when we hear it, and seek to glorify you in all we do. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
Thank you, Senator. We have one bill on our agenda today. House Bill 520. It's for a hearing only. We're not voting on this bill today. The hearing is being live streamed on the legislative website, and it's also visible on the TVs outside of the committee room. We're going to have the bill presented, starting with Representative Jones, Sherman Jones, and Representative Oliver. Okay, the floor is yours.
Can you hear me? Okay, perfect. Thank you very much, Madam Chairwoman. Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. I appreciate that, and I appreciate the opportunity, as does Representative Oliver, to present House Bill 520 to you today. I am going to, for the purposes of the committee, I'm going to cover sections 3, 6, 10, 11, 14, 15, 16, 17, and the latter part of 19. Representative Oliver will come around on the remaining 20. Are not the remaining 20, but of the 20, she'll do the remainder, and then also the first part of 19. We wanted to start with these because these were the ones that, frankly, that we understand that you were hearing the most amount of questions about, and we felt as if we should hit those head on, as opposed to just going through it in a numerical order. We felt as if that would be helpful for the committee to basically understand exactly what the process was in terms of how we got here. Representative Oliver will go through a series of different, I'll say, ways that the information was put together, but ultimately, please know this, the Behavioral Health Commission, along with all of its subcommittee chairs, were absolutely critical and integral in terms of the development of House Bill 520. Moving on to Section 3 of House Bill 520, one of the things that you will see inside of this bill is of the 20 sections, 5 of them are literally studies in terms of 5 out of the 20, and Section 3 fills that slot very, very well. This was one that came out of Chief Justice Boggs' subcommittee, and it really focuses on serious mental illness and then also on familiar faces. The focus here is to be able to put together all of the stakeholders who are involved in this very critical group of people. Whether or not you own a business or whether or not you're just managing a family, the fact is you look for that one small piece of data or that one small group that is taking up a significant amount of your resources, and that is effectively your familiar faces. These are individuals that are known in the homeless community, they are known within the healthcare community, and they're also known within, unfortunately, the law enforcement, the incarceration, maybe the sheriff or maybe the DOC. It's absolutely imperative, since these individuals make up probably 1% of all the mental health patients we have in this state or less, that we get a hold of this, basically this crazy cycle they're on. And if you can think of a three-legged stool, they're going from homelessness to healthcare into incarceration, and they just keep going. They may make up 1% or less than 1% of our mental health community, but they take up an exorbitant amount of the resources. Hence, we've asked all the stakeholders, and you see that in Section 3, to get together and really finalize what do we see as a proper definition, and then how it is would be some of the ways that we could address that. Again, recommendations. Moving on to Section 6, this is another one of the 5 study sections. This is a bed study. We've been asked several times, why do we need a bed study? This is not just about counting beds. This is about understanding not just the number of beds inside of the state of Georgia, but also the types of beds. Are they inpatient? Are they outpatient? Are they acute? Are they extended care, etc.? And then equally important, you will see in there that we also need to know, are they in-state or out-of-state residents currently occupying those beds? One of the things that we find from this type of information is that we know that our reimbursement rates are so low compared to our neighboring states when it comes to Medicaid reimbursement that a lot of these for-profit entities are actually incented to take out-of-state cash-paying customers as opposed to a Georgia citizen. Sections 10 and 11 are effectively mirrors of each other, one regarding mental health and one regarding substance abuse. Effectively, one of the things that you all have been hearing about are, quote, the two affidavits. And the two affidavits declaring whether or not someone may have mental illness or whether or not they may have substance abuse issues. Let me be perfectly clear, that is existing law that has literally been there for decades. That is not new law. We are not treading new ground. That is something that has been there. People ask all the time, why not just a physician's order? Well, unfortunately, here in the state of Georgia, not proud of this stat, but we have counties without doctors. I'll say that one more time. We have counties without doctors. The second type of person who's going to be helped by this is that individual, like the 17-year-old who came up to me at a town hall and said, my mom has the ability to, quote, stay straight when the police are there, and then she immediately devolves as soon as the police leave. Imagine that. We're expecting the police to witness it. They can't witness it, so they can't effectively start the process, but yet this 17-year-old has become effectively the adult of the house. So this is not an avenue that is taken often in current law. Typically, it is the physician's order that is taken. However, our feeling is that not only is that existing law, but what we wanted to do was attach the physician's order or the two affidavits to the judge's order. So keep in mind, the two affidavits go in front of a judge. That order then goes with the patient to the hospital. We, at that point, and you'll see in the new language, we ask that the affiant's names be redacted there. That is strictly from a public safety and from a public safety point of view. We do not want an individual who may be violent or who may be wanting to get some type of revenge after being put into that space to come after those individuals. Let me be clear. Those affidavits, along with the names and all the information on those affidavits, are part of the court record. They can be obviously opened up by the court. They can be opened up by proper, you know, lawyering in terms of getting that information. This is not information that suddenly is redacted forever, but rather it remains. Moving on to section 14 and 15. Surprised that the pushback on 14 and 15, because this is essentially the exact same language of 43-35-5.1. I'll say that reference one more time, 43-35-5.1, that went in 2010, including the entity language around immunity. In 2010, we put it in for the doctors. In 2023, what we're asking for is to put this in for mental health professionals and nurses. Effectively, from a workforce development standpoint, and I'll just use, and this is just an example, a 35-year-old nurse gets addicted to OxyContin. We would like that nurse to somehow stay in the workforce once they get rehab, not lose their license forever. This allows them to be able to go to the licensing board and basically admit that they are addicted. They probably get their license, if they do get their license, suspended, and then they go through rehab and they go through testing, et cetera, et cetera, 90 days, 120 days, whatever is prescribed by the doctor, and then ultimately the entity will prescribe back to the licensing board a recommendation of whether or not they should get their license back or not. Let me be clear. 2 years from now, if that nurse does something wrong, or that nurse does, you know, in terms of at least an assumption of malpractice, all the information is absolutely discoverable inside of any type of court proceeding. Section 16 is another one that is regarding data sharing. I think it's imperative that we all understand that effectively our governor sits within the Constitution to be one of the most powerful governors within the entire United States from a constitutional standpoint. That's not an opinion of Mr. Kemp, but rather just what the Constitution gives in terms of authority and responsibility to the governor. Over the years, that responsibility has been split up into a myriad of different agencies. We all can basically say the alphabet soup names. What you'll see is there are databases within each one of those entities, but ultimately, there's an executive branch file cabinet, for lack of a better phrase, and there are folders within that file cabinet that represent each one of the agencies. What we want to be able to do is have those agencies share the data. I'll say that one more time. Share the data, but under federal law, state law, and then also the basically taking out PII, making sure that it's limited, making sure that's encrypted at rest, encrypted during transit, etc. So this by no means strikes any responsibility when it comes to the privacy, when it comes to cyber best practices, but rather it allows for us to have a function, and you will see in there that a director is appointed for the GDAC, and ultimately that individual will be the one that will determine if that data can be shared, and if it can be shared, it must go underneath all current federal and state laws. There's an appeals process in there to the Executive Council of the governor. But ultimately, what we're trying to do here is this, everyone. We want to basically determine, is there a way to help? Can we help with the data that we have? We see businesses every day look at data and determine, is there a trend line that would be able to help the citizens of Georgia, and how can we be proactive? Section 17, and I'm almost done, I got Section 17, a latter part of 19. Section 17, there's been a significant amount of, I'll say, conjecture regarding Medicaid and what that is doing. I want to be clear, there is no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. One more time, there's no expansion of the roles of Medicaid in any of those subsections. What it does, though, is you will see Section A, for instance, those individuals that would get those three existing diagnostic codes, they are already qualified for Medicaid and getting a series of services from Medicaid. However, those three diagnostic codes, we believe, will save the state a significant amount of money because they're diagnostic codes. If we have a better understanding of what that individual's challenge is, we can come up with a better treatment plan, and hopefully that individual is able to get better or at least get stabilized in a shorter amount of time, hence reducing the amount of resources that the state has to pay for that. You will then see further down in D, E, and F, I believe, or C, D, and E, you will see that is effectively moving that into the state plan. Right now it's in CMS, and then moving that into the state plan. That effectively calls for the state already doing most of that work to effectively do that work. But to be clear, it does not expand the roles. And then finally, Section 19, I'll take the second half of that, and I'll allow Representative Oliver to take the first half. The second half of that speaks to the repayment of loans. Let me be perfectly clear. We have a problem. I don't say that tongue in cheek. I don't say that as some type of, you know, political comment. But we literally have, just like we have counties without doctors, we have counties and communities without mental health professionals. We have counties and communities without substance abuse professionals. So how do we find a way to get these individuals into Lanier County, into Ware County, into Echols County? I can keep going. But I think it's imperative that we are able to say to ourselves, how can we do that? And I think it's important that we look at that in such a way that how can we as a state use our resources appropriately? This is not the paying off of student loans. If someone went to NYU and took on $250,000 of student loans, I would say to them, I don't think that was a good decision, but that's my own personal opinion, but this does not relieve them of that. Rather, it's $10,000 a year for up to 5 years if they remain in that underserved community. And to that point, to line 1021, I do believe that we either need to narrowly define underserved youth or we need to redact that completely. But after having more and more time with that, I don't believe that underserved youth, I think it's too broad, and I think we either need to take it out or we need to define it better. But the next line around underserved areas, I think, is well defined, and I wanted to make sure you know that. Finally, there was a colleague of mine who came to me on Thursday of last week, who I thought made a very good recommendation for the latter part of 19, and that's what I'm going to call the public good clause. And effectively what he said was, what we can do is help communities to better see, I'll say, the effects of mental health and substance abuse, and what could these individuals that the state has said, you know what, you're so important, we need you down there, is there a way through some type of best practice within their loan document, not to do anything other than say, given best practices, commercial best practices, what type of information could you provide to the community to help them understand what would be the, I'll say, first indicators or second indicators of mental health or substance abuse? Madam Chairwoman, that is the end of my comments.
Thank you, and I know you're going to have to leave, but we're going to go ahead, Representative Oliver, if you could cover the other sections, and then if you're willing to take all the questions, that'd be great.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm very happy to be here, and I appreciate the privilege of presenting another opportunity for the state to move forward on mental health reform. What is different this year than was presented to you in 1013? I'd like to take just a moment to talk about that. In 1013, we came to the General Assembly with a number of different recommendations that came from the Behavioral Health and Innovation Commission, chaired by Kevin Tanner. And we put into 1013 a number of different work efforts that have resulted in specific, because they were tasks defined, because there was a date and there was an accountability to respond to the tasks set forth in legislation, we have new products about which we can move forward. For instance, the prescription formulary had been signed to many different agencies, but had never been accomplished. 1013 said one agency, Governor's Health Innovation Strategy Commission, shall do it. They did it in a timely manner. We had a transportation study accomplished, which allows Kevin Tanner now to move forward with a pilot project on the transportation of mentally ill patients, which is a controversy within our sheriff's and law enforcement department. I just give those two examples to show that setting out a work plan, making an entity accountable, and getting a result allows you to take the next step of good management. And good management is using the taxpayers' money effectively in a focused way. What's different in 2022 and 2023 and 520 is that in addition to the committee, subcommittee process that was set up by the Behavioral Health Commission, we have had significant contributions from the executive agencies this year that we did not have last year. The subcommittees, as you may remember, are chaired by Justice Boggs, or judge in relation to criminal justice issues, chaired by Judge Amaro in relation to involuntary commitment, chaired by Dr. Brenda Fitzgerald in relation to child and adolescent behavioral health, and I had the privilege of chairing the workforce subcommittee. Each of our subcommittees met on a monthly basis. We have a several hundred page report. All of our committees are recorded and you can watch them at any length you like. Differently this year, Grant Thomas and the Health Strategy and Coordination Commission has been a major contributor in the issue of data collection and data sharing. Obviously, Kevin Tanner in his new role, important new role as Commissioner of Behavioral Health and Developmental Disability, he is now more actively engaged in this bill in relation to bolstering some of the tasks that are necessary in the forensic population within his agency. There's 641 forensic beds. It's the only real psychiatric hospital the state manages. He's also been active in asking for work in the bed study and asking for work in the staffing analysis. Justice Boggs has become, as you know, a national leader in relation to criminal justice reform, and that has turned into a deeper dive into the behavioral health folks that are incarcerated in the 143 jails that we have across Georgia. Justice Boggs, because he's a leader, has been able to attract national grant money and national attention, and a number of different sections of this bill come from him. A number of sections come from Grant Thomas, and a number of other sections come from Commissioner Tanner. And I'm pleased to talk about them briefly, as to the extent the chair would like me to talk about the other parts of the bill, but also answer questions. We know, and I don't need to tell you this, that workforce is the biggest challenge facing all the social service agencies and all of the state of Georgia, if not as well as the private businesses across our state. As chair of the Workforce Study Committee, we have focused on not only the loan forgiveness and the alternative disciplinary process that's been successful for doctors and 10 other health professionals for about a decade. The licensing board issues gained a lot of attention in our subcommittee discussions. And we looked at the way other states are modernizing the procedures by going on in line with different kind of programs. The era of filling out a form in pencil and mailing it in with a check just doesn't exist anymore. And the licensing board analysis, we had probably 25 to 40 different specific suggestions for modernization, and we turned that into giving again to the governor's executive commission, the strategy and coordination commission, the task of giving to us a report within 6 months of all of these 25 different recommendations. We know that the use of foreign trained professionals is extensively a strong aspect of the way we're recruiting staff. 10% of Georgians are born in another country, speak another language, and other states around us have set up specialized, more modern ways to move foreign-trained professionals into our healthcare system using what I think of as the HN1 farm program. It is being used by some of our private hospitals in order to bring the daily service providers in to deal with patients. In relation to the, I met this morning, I met several times, but I met again this morning with Kaylee Noggle on the complications of the issues that are set forth in Section 17. What is a doable without legislation, the state plan? What is doable in a waiver? And what is doable in the procurement contracts? There's a lot of moving parts to all that. But what we do know is that our children in Georgia who have mental health crisis are not being served adequately. 40% of our state's 600 beds, intensive psychiatric beds in Georgia, are filled by out-of-state children. Our reimbursement rates are inadequate to manage this kind of gift we are providing to other states around us and not providing to the children in Georgia. In 1013, we did a deep data analysis about where a certain number of our health professionals are working, and for us to give a better understanding of how we would distribute monies on the loan forgiveness plan. And the second part of Section 19 that Representative Jones referred to expands that list of medical professionals who we need more information. Where do they practice? Do they have a license but retired now? Where are they willing to take additional responsibilities or benefits that they might be able to extend? These are the kinds of questions that the real data analysis has to bring forward for us to make the next step. I want to say that Commissioner Christopher Nunn also has participated in this bill. He wanted the task we're giving him. There are many different streams of funding, all of which are federal and private, substantially all of which. There's about $1 million that goes for homeless from state money, but it's essentially federal money. The different streams and the different use of COVID money and ARPA money has all given us an opportunity. Christopher Nunn wants us to give him this obligation again for accountability and a date to look at the funding streams for homeless and figure out how does this homeless population again create greater stress on our businesses as they live invisibly in our community and greater stress on our jail population. Madam Chair, that might be a good spot to pause, and I'm happy to answer questions or proceed in any way you would like.
Thanks to everyone for coming down. Stay tuned. This is a long process. We're just the beginning of it. Thanks very much for joining.
I'm going to start the video.